Hello, and welcome to the White House Historical Association's annual observance of the birthday of First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy. Mrs. Kennedy founded the association in 1961, and we have been proud to be her living legacy in historic preservation in the White House ever since. My name is Stewart McLaurin, and I'm privileged to be the president of the association, and my colleagues and I are honored to bring this program to you today, as well as a program at noon tomorrow and at 5:30 Eastern on Thursday. And we hope that you've registered for all three programs. The White House Historical Association is a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization that serves as the private partner to the White House. Our mission and our role have been consistent, working with 11 presidents and first ladies dating back to the Kennedys in 1961. Our non-taxpayer funding supports conservation and preservation work in the White House to maintain that beautiful museum standard that Mrs. Kennedy envisioned for the staterooms, for the ground floor rooms, and for the non-public historic rooms in the White House. We've had the privilege of funding the acquisitions of art and furnishings for the permanent White House collection in collaboration with every president and first lady for the past 60 years. It was also important to Mrs. Kennedy that we undertake an education mission. That began with the publication of the first White House Visitor Guide in 1961, and we're currently in the 24th edition of that important book. We also continue that today in the 24th edition of the guidebook, as well as our White House History Quarterly magazine. These programs, in her honor, over the next 3 days, demonstrate our robust education program, which also includes conferences, symposia, teacher institute, and our website filled with abundant content for teachers, students, journalists, and anyone interested in White House history. White House history is American history, and we believe it is our unique role and responsibility to share these stories and preserve this wonderful, rich history for the American people. Today, we are fortunate to have with us two terrific friends of the White House Historical Association, Mr. David Rubenstein and Dr. Douglas Brinkley, who have just joined me on the screen. David Rubenstein is chairman and co-founder of the Carlyle Group, and he defines the words patriotic philanthropy. He has been a generous supporter to many organizations in Washington and across the country, including the White House Historical Association and the David M. Rubenstein National Center for White House History, which is our academic and scholarly work here at the Association, is named in his honor. Dr. Douglas Brinkley is a renowned American historian and has written and spoken extensively on the Kennedys. In fact, his new book coming out in 2021 on President Kennedy is Silent Spring Revolution, Rachel Carson, John Kennedy, and the Dawn of the 60s Environmental Movement. Following Mr. Rubenstein and Dr. Brinkley, stay tuned for a special vignette with former White House executive pastry chef Roland Mesnier, who will pay a tribute to Mrs. Kennedy featuring one of her White House desserts. And please be thinking of questions that you would like to ask Dr. Brinkley and Mr. Rubenstein. At the end of their conversation, I will rejoin the program and pose those questions to them. Mr. Rubenstein, Dr. Brinkley, thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you very much, Stuart, and thank you for the outstanding job you've done for the White House Historical Association. You really strengthened it and really energized it, and I'm very proud to be associated with it. And Doug, thank you very much for doing this. I have read your previous books relating to John Kennedy. One is on the moonshot, which talks about his effort to get man to the moon before the end of the decade. And then another encyclopedic book that you've done that's quite good about JFK that you did not long ago, in which you had some of the leading people in the United States write about JFK, and you edited that and wrote your own part. So a very impressive book. So let's, for those people who may not be your generation or my generation, I'm a little older than you, they may not know the history of Mrs. Kennedy and John Kennedy. For younger people, when did John Kennedy meet Mrs. Kennedy, and was it love at first sight? Who introduced them?
Well, David, I really thank you for doing this, and happy birthday to Mrs. Kennedy. She was, of course, a Beauvoir. Jacqueline Beauvoir met young John F. Kennedy in 1951. They met at a dinner. Charles Bartlett, a journalist, introduced them. And it was a little bit of love on first sight, particularly for Jackie, as I'm going to call her in our interview today, because she had begun trying to go into different things. And she was really at that age of, she was considered a big debutante in New York City, but moved to DC and was looking to get married. And here was this handsome, witty, debonair dinner partner that she had, and they fell for each other. I think a big bond was their common Catholicism. She, you know, spoke fluent, and she was fluent in Spanish and French, but was a Catholic girl, and here he was a Catholic boy, and I think that meant a lot. So they get married the next year. They met in 51, and by 52, they get married in Newport, Rhode Island. About 1,200 guests were there. It made all of the social papers as the big wedding of the year. She had worked previously for a day or two at Vogue, so she was already kind of in the fashion world. And it became a storybook relationship right out of the gate due to the media coverage of the wedding.
Now, was she interested in politics particularly?
You know what, David, she was. She was very interested in literature. She went to George Washington University and studied French literature. She had spent time traveling and studying in France, but she just loved novels and books, art and culture, I think more so than John F. Kennedy, who preferred, he was also an avid reader, but he liked books by Winston Churchill and T.H. Lawrence and the like. So they had a little bit of different taste, but together they believed in the arts and the written word. They both could enjoy talking to writers and journalists, probably more than they did people that worked in government. But she was one that very much backed John F. Kennedy's career, not just when he first ran for senator in 52, but when he ran again in 58, and then when he ran again in 60. Some people have thought, David, that she perhaps didn't love politics because she didn't campaign a lot in 1960 when he ran for president. But alas, she was pregnant, and she had had a miscarriage previously. And so she was careful not to burn herself out on the campaign trail in 60. In fact, for the presidential debates, the first in American history against Nixon, she stayed back in Hyannisport and wasn't there to be at the debate. So she low-keyed it in 60, but that shouldn't be a reflection of how avidly she believed, not just in Jack Kennedy, but later in Bobby Kennedy's political career. She urged Bobby Kennedy in 1964 to run for Senate from New York and run for president in 1968.
So she was pregnant with John Kennedy, and John Kennedy Jr. was born, I guess, shortly before President Kennedy took office. Jacqueline Kennedy participated in a ritual that we've been doing for some years, which is the first ladies who are outgoing give a tour to the new first lady. Did Mamie Eisenhower want to give a tour to Jackie Kennedy? And if so, how did that tour actually go?
I mean, the problem was the White House by the time of 1961 was kind of in a shambles, because it used to be anybody could take items out of the White House. So it had gotten kind of stripped bare. I'm not blaming Mamie Eisenhower for that, but all of the first ladies previously, nobody became a custodian really of the of it. And so Jackie Kennedy, though, was incredibly kind to Mamie Eisenhower and would be to all first ladies afterwards. She would visit the White House, obviously, with Lyndon Johnson and Lady Bird, she was friends with, but later she became friendly with Nancy Reagan and would visit. So she believed very much in civility, and that for all the first ladies needed to be their special club if you'd like.
Well, when she got her tour right before the inauguration from Mamie Eisenhower, did she come back and say it looks wonderful and it doesn't need any restoration? Or did she say maybe we could fix it up a little bit?
Maybe we can fix it up a little bit. That, it was underwhelming, the tour. And she wouldn't, and I say that in a way that Jackie Kennedy was not putting Mamie Eisenhower down or grandstanding, that I come from wealth and I can make the White House look beautiful. She just thought that this should be repaired as a people's house or as a repository for U.S. history, that the art and furnishings needed to be upgraded, and that the objects in the White House should be administered by the Smithsonian Institution instead of it being done in a kind of willy-nilly way. And she took this on because, as we've just mentioned, she had two children, little children. So she wasn't really looking to go traveling with two little kids. So she was in the White House a lot, and it gave her a project to identify with the beautification of the White House. And of course, it becomes such a big event because not only does she do a first-rate job, and remember, John F. Kennedy did the same thing with Air Force One. I mean, he did this massive restoration. The Air Force One should look good. The White House should look good. The Rose Garden. They were really believers in that the White House and the symbols of the presidency needed an upgrading. And of course, they were so popular with newspapers and magazines like Life and Look that famously CBS News evening program decided to sign Mrs. Kennedy up to show the renovated White House to the American people, because up until that point, it was kind of a closed house. Most people couldn't imagine what the White House looked like.
So that show was one of the highest rated shows on TV at the time. She gave a tour, I think with Charles Collingwood, of the White House that she had helped restore. But where did she get the money for that restoration? Was it taxpayer money, or where did it come from?
Some, and she found monies around government to do a kind of a way to just start instituting it. What she did well was make it known that this was going to be a public-private partnership, but that we were going to have a White House Historical Association. That's why we're celebrating her, and that we were going to make sure that the American people got educated on life at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. The TV show, I think, even had to have caught her by surprise, meaning when it aired, the ratings bonanza that CBS got, and Collingwood, television hadn't seen anything like it. She would go on to win an Emmy Award for the show. And it's that voice that she had, you know, that kind of soft, feminine voice in some ways, but it had a kind of a melodic tone to it. And she, of course, was, always looked so beautiful in her wardrobe and fashion. She became a symbol of modern sophistication. You know, we use the word cool a lot, but this period in the early 60s were cool. Jack and Jacqueline Kennedy seemed cool, fashionable, hip, in the Frank Sinatra way. And Jackie Kennedy, for example, would tell the press, "I read Jack Kerouac's On the Road," which was considered a beatnik novel. Well, no first lady would read that, or that she admired things that, Mark Rothko, a modern painter, was doing. So she brought a sense of modernity to the White House in her persona. At the same time, she was preserving artifacts of our national history.
So when she did that show, it was well received, in part, I thought, because very few people in those days had actually seen the inside of the White House, either because the Eisenhowers didn't telecast it, or it just wasn't something where television was that popular then. So was it the unusual nature of seeing the White House that was part of the appeal, or was it seeing her, or the combination of things that made it such a popular show?
I think it's the combo. But I think you're asking the right question, David. I mean, the White House was sort of, remember, Harry Truman had to live in Blair House part of the time. Eisenhower got popular for Camp David, the old Shangri-La camp of FDR, but we're going in the Maryland woods. And Eisenhower had a heart attack and had been in Denver for a while and would go golfing and fly fishing. And he wasn't really a creature, Dwight Eisenhower, of the White House culture. But you're right, in the age of television, meaning the 50s, nobody had ever seen the White House, what it was like, and nobody really had any feel for it at all. And now suddenly everybody was awing and gazing as she led a great guided tour, the First Lady taking you through. But also, as I said, because of her children born so close together and she was a mother, you felt this sort of intimacy that you were seeing where the Kennedys live. And this new era of 1960s television, anything Kennedy was, you know, Jack Kennedy had pioneered the press conference and those got high ratings. And our space, you know, with Alan Shepard or John Glenn got boomer bonanza ratings. CBS News was only 15 minutes and NBC were only 15 minutes of nightly news. But when the Kennedys in the White House, they expanded it to the 30-minute nightly newscast because Kennedys were good copy. And even their time up in Hyannisport and Cape Cod got mythologized. The Newport races got covered. It became a sort of a moment in time where the country was really enjoying the fact that 15 years passed since World War II ended, that we were now in the jet age, and that the Kennedys were this young couple with young kids, and the fact that she was willing to be this sophisticated guide through the White House was just irresistible, must-watch television, and the ratings showed that.
Remind people how young she was when she became First Lady.
Yeah, she's in her 30s, and you know, it's hard to imagine being a First Lady that young. You know, we think of First Ladies being in their, you know, I think of Eleanor Roosevelt, for example, or you're at least in your 40s, but man, you're in your 30s and you're First Lady and a mother with two kids. And she did travel a lot. I mean, I would say besides the White House restoration, which we're honoring on this particular birthday, I think her other, in her fashion and some of the things in tone and temperament that we're talking about, but she was a rock star globally. I mean, famously, when she went to France because she spoke fluent French or could speak Spanish fluently, when she went to Latin America, most heads of state were more interested in meeting her than they were John F. Kennedy. In fact, Kennedy made a famous quip about that. Nikita Khrushchev just went wild over her and ended up gifting Jackie a little puppy named that was from the puppy from one of the Soviet dogs that went into space and gave her as a gift a dog. And so the number of countries she went to, I had marked them down here, but I don't want to read them all off. But I mean, it wasn't slight. She just kept traveling and traveling and traveling abroad and became our great ambassador. She was in India for a long time with John Kenneth Galbraith, the ambassador, and wherever she went, she got rave reviews.
So what was the famous line that John Kennedy gave in Paris, and what did she do to persuade the French to lend the Mona Lisa to the National Gallery of Art?
Well, all she had to do was ask to get the Mona Lisa. She was that popular in France, but Jack Kennedy kindly said, you know, I'm just the, you know, everybody wants to see my wife. I'm just an appendage. Nobody even cares about me. They all care about her. There's no exaggerating how impressed the French in particular and Charles de Gaulle were that she spoke beautiful finishing school French, perfect French, in that she had read all of the French masterpieces of literature and knew everything about French art. For France, this is only Ben Franklin had equaled that role in American history and in an ambassadorial sense. And France was an important partner of the United States in this period of time, and particularly with their vote in the United Nations Security Council, in which you had Britain and the United States usually voting together, but then you had China and Russia sometimes together, so France could be a deciding vote on Security Council issues, the role within of NATO and France, the thought of the force de frappe that de Gaulle was going to be developing his own nuclear force, France's role in Africa. For all these reasons, France was a very important country in that all of France was in love with the United States because of Jackie Kennedy.
Now, there were some old buildings across the street from the White House that were going to be torn down. And I think President Kennedy went along with GSA's recommendation that they be torn down and some new buildings be built. What did Jackie Kennedy try to do to stop that from happening?
Yeah, she didn't like anything being torn down. She was actually a history she did renovations. And she saw some of the buildings that in that period of time in Washington were seen as throwaway buildings or eyesores. She saw that they needed renovation and could have a beautification. She really imagined, maybe not this moment with protests all over, you know, things boarded up in front of the White House, but she imagined the area around Lafayette Park as being, it being brought into the White House. So it was a part of Washington to explore and preserve. And that same that idea was being promoted by William O. Douglas, Supreme Court Justice. And when John F. Kennedy was killed, Lady Bird Johnson, the other first lady, started taking what Jackie did for White House renovation and that part of Washington along the Mall and extended it to all of D.C. So the 1960s was a big era of beautification of federal property and buildings, even while other neighborhoods in Washington were experiencing blight.
Now, Jackie Kennedy liked high culture, and I think she was responsible for inviting Pablo Casals to come to the White House and perform. Was that a famous dinner that evening?
Very famous dinner. In fact, Jackie and John and John F. Kennedy and Jackie had the great dinners of all time, because they put music at the forefront. You know, they used to invite the best writers, poets, musicians, artists. It was a high water mark of society. I mean, remember John F. Kennedy's inaugural, he had Robert Frost famously read that inaugural poem. We had the Pulitzer Prize winning novelist Wallace Stegner living in and out of the Interior Department writing government pamphlets. Carl Sandburg, the great old poet of America and biographer of Abraham Lincoln, was a regular guest. And this became made the White House exciting. It's a good point you're raising, because it's not just the restoration and refurbishing and touring the White House, but it made the White House seem to be the central place you wanted to be in the sense of for diplomatic excellence, but also the sense of the power of performing arts. There is no more fitting tribute to John F. Kennedy in my mind than the naming of the Performing Arts Center in Washington after him, David, that I know you work a lot with. But, you know, Jackie Kennedy is a big part of that spirit of the Kennedy Performing Arts Center.
So toward the tragic last weekend, President Kennedy asked Jackie Kennedy to accompany him to Texas. Why did he want her to come to Texas with him on a political mission?
Well, they had lost a baby, often forgotten, but in the August of 63, they would have had a third child, actually a fourth, first one, as I mentioned, of miscarriage. But at any rate, the infant died, and she was depressed. And this trip to Texas was a sort of reuniting of their marriage, meaning rekindling the friendship, the love, the handholding to try to get over the grief of that loss. And November was the beginning of a political season. I mean, it was a year out. Texas was the all-important political state. Kennedy barely won Texas and probably only won it because Lyndon Johnson was on his ticket as vice president. So they went to Texas and had a fabulous time by all accounts together as a loving couple. They were in San Antonio together and in Houston for a congressman, Albert Thomas, who was important for space appropriations, but Houston congressman Jackie Kennedy not only spoke, but then she went and spoke to a Latino group and spoke all in Spanish, and she was getting cheered and everybody was commenting how beautiful she looked. So they had a big success in San Antonio and Houston. Then they went to Fort Worth and spent the night, their last night as a married couple in the hotel there. If you go to Fort Worth today, it's commemorated was where they were and had a nice morning, then made their way into Dallas for that fateful drive in the convertible where her husband used to have to wear back braces, came from his Addison's disease, but also she had to help him constantly with health problems with the pain in his back. So President Kennedy had like a brace, almost like a board, so he could sit up straight. So when you watch the assassination footage, you could see he couldn't fall over normally because of that contraption on his back. And she forever was wearing that pink Chanel suit and the pillbox hat and that horror of her having anybody's husband's brains blown out on her, on you know, in front of you. And when they went to Parkland Hospital, she wandered around there trying to see how her husband was doing, and we refused to change her outfit. She continued to wear that bloody Chanel suit onto Air Force One, and Lyndon Johnson would not take off from Dallas without her on the plane. And he wanted to make sure she witnessed that pulled together swearing in. That is such a famous photograph of Johnson suddenly becoming president. She went back, the grieving widow, and had the burden of planning everything. Where would JFK be buried? We'd be buried at Arlington or on Cape Cod. What world leaders would come? And mainly, how do I protect my children from this particular horror? Everybody believed that Jackie Kennedy did a marvelous job of grace under pressure, on that quality that John F. Kennedy admired so much, that Ernest Hemingway admired so much, grace under pressure. She showed that quality throughout that funeral at Arlington. And then after the burial, she came to the White House to meet with Lyndon and Lady Bird Johnson. And she had a request in that they keep Jack's dream alive, the dream of going to the moon by the end of the decade. And Lyndon Johnson told Lady Bird, the first thing we're doing is naming Cape Canaveral the Kennedy Space Center. And that one of the reasons why the Gemini, which are two astronauts, and Apollo 3 kept aiming for the moon in the 60s, is Jackie Kennedy wanted to see that part of her husband's dream fulfilled.
So one of the most iconic pictures of that funeral in November of 1963 was little John Kennedy saluting. Who taught him how to salute, and why is that picture so famous?
Oh, it's just a killer, because of the saluting. You know, he was living around seeing his father saluted by everybody, by the military, as a little boy, and then saluting, the salute goodbye to one's father. It was an image that broke the heart of America. It made the country love John F. Kennedy Jr., who himself died tragically after editing George magazine and then died in an air crash. Some people had high hopes for him in politics. So that sense of loss of the children and the widow, and there's something about an American innocence gone. Quickly, books came out. Jackie Kennedy made a deal with William Rand. I don't mean a financial deal, but allowed William Manchester to write a book on the death of the president about what happened. And then later she tried to stop that book from coming out. She herself gave a very long oral history about her time as first lady for the Kennedy Library in Boston. And in one way or another, she helped out Ted Sorensen, chief speechwriter, and Arthur Schlesinger, the historian who wrote 1,000 Days, with their book. She remained very close and good friends with Schlesinger, Sorensen, John Kenneth Galbraith, and particularly also Stuart Udall, the Secretary of Interior, who, when she was trying to heal, went on rafting trips with Udall out west. They went to the Grand Canyon and Idaho and places to kind of get away. And she eventually refound herself after years of mourning and helping Bobby Kennedy's political career, but returning to her love of books and becoming an editor for Doubleday.
People forget how young she was when she was first lady. She was first lady just at 31. President Kennedy died when she was 34, but she tragically died at the age of just 64.
Yeah, you know, I thought about that today, David, too, who was looking at her birth date because of this is what we're celebrating today. But, she, of course, became Onassis and became a feature of tabloids in New York, probably the most sought after woman in the world to be at a social event or party. Had two children that were making their marks in American life. And so I tend to think of her as living longer. She died at that young age of 64, and succumbed to cancer and was never able to, live that extra decade or two. I think people don't realize how young she died because she was such a young first lady that she had been with us as a public figure for many, many decades.
Okay. So, Stewart, welcome. You're muted.
Thank you very much. Thank you both. It's a wonderful conversation. You know, one of the things I say I love about my job is every day I learn something new, and I appreciate learning from both of you today. But we do have some questions from our audience. It's been a very active audience side conversation that's been going on. We'll ask just a few of these. With Mrs. Trump's announcement this week about a Rose Garden renovation, what was the Kennedy role with the modern Rose Garden?
Well, if I'll take this one, but I mean, she was the one who, the progenitor of beautifying of the Rose Garden. It's even called the Jacqueline Kennedy Rose Garden. That was really her idea to make that such a special place, such a special ground. So whenever I hear, just like when I hear Camp David, you think of Dwight Eisenhower. When I hear Rose Garden, I think of Jacqueline Kennedy's efforts for it. I'm uncertain why Melania Trump's decided on that at this moment in time, but anything that beautifies the grounds of the White House, whether it's Michelle Obama's organic, farming and planting of vegetables and the like, I approved of that, and I approve of trying to make the Rose Garden even a more special place.
Yeah, I would just add that one of her close friends was Bunny Mellon, who was married to Paul Mellon. And she was an expert in horticulture. And so Jackie Kennedy asked Bunny Mellon if she would kind of help design what now we call the Rose Garden. And it's really stayed almost unchanged since that time.
So here's a question for both of you. If you could both have lunch with Mrs. Kennedy today and ask her about her legacy, do you think she would be surprised that what she put in place, I guess like the White House Historical Association, still has the impact that it does today?
Doug?
I don't think she would be surprised. I think because that Charles Collingwood interview was when we're talking about the ratings bonanza of all time and the public interest that took place in the White House and her work, and it became a big part of her legacy. I'm just like Lady Bird Johnson was for no billboards and highway beautification and national parks. I think both Jackie Kennedy and Lady Bird at the time they died, realized that that would be a giant part of their legacy and their philanthropy, almost their giving to the country. The reason I'm interested in both is I just love historic preservation, and no building's more important to preserve than the White House, period. And then I love the idea of arboretums and grounds being kept well, like the Rose Garden or just the whole mall. Everything that David does in Washington, D.C. to help our Washington Monument and the Library of Congress and just make our nation's capital that special, that I always get moved when people come from around the world and said to me, "Oh my God, I had no idea Washington, D.C. is so beautiful." We have no idea, because they think of New York City as being American. They come to Washington and it can just floor you, the tidal basin and the beauty of some of our federal buildings and monuments. And I'm appreciative of people like David and Jackie Kennedy. And as I mentioned, Lady Bird Johnson for of cueing in the country that this matters, that this is our legacy as a society.
One of the legacies that she might have been surprised about is this. Except for Eleanor Roosevelt, many of her predecessors didn't really take on public causes. Mamie Eisenhower and Bess Truman were not that actively involved in public events or that much of a persona themselves. And now, since Jackie Kennedy, I think many first ladies feel they need to have a cause or more than one cause. And I think part of that is the legacy of what Jackie Kennedy did.
Yeah, I agree with that. And we saw that really with Melania. I mean, remember when the inauguration of Donald Trump took place, Melania Trump, stylistically, I mean, just physically was dressed like Jackie Kennedy. I mean, her influence on fashion, Jackie Kennedy, is still very widely felt today. And I recently toured the Walker Art Museum in Minneapolis, one of our nation's best art museums, and there's Andy Warhol's multiple Jackie Kennedys on an important wall of this art museum. So the image of her and as the no, most people don't picture as much as being in her 60s. They picture her as the young first lady in her 30s. A lot of polls will show popularity of, you know, Eleanor Roosevelt and Dolly Madison and Jacqueline Kennedy always are ranked very high in the public public esteem as first ladies. And all the other first ladies wanted to meet Jackie Kennedy. They wanted to, you know, have some of her magic in one way or another.
On a point that Doug raised earlier, one of her legacies was the Kennedy Center in this respect. After President Kennedy died, the family decided, principally led by Jackie Kennedy, that they wanted to have a living memorial to President Kennedy. And the National Cultural Center, on which he had spent some time helping to raise money, was decided to be renamed as the John F. Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts. It opened almost 50 years ago in 1971. And the architect was somebody selected by Jackie Kennedy, an architect she had admired. And she was really involved in opening that cultural center to everybody, and to creating the Kennedy Center is really her legacy as much as anybody's.
And we do a great thanks at the Kennedy Center as the living memorial to President Kennedy. I'm also fans of the Kennedy Library in Boston, which carries on the legacy and the great work that they did in the White House. Here's a question from Kate. Was the White House renovation effort put into jeopardy following the sudden death of President Kennedy? And did Mrs. Johnson carry on this work?
Yes, the White House continued to be renovated. Anything that Jackie Kennedy had wanted done, Lyndon and Lady Bird continued. They could not have been more gracious to Jackie Kennedy in 1964, 65, 66. There was a while where Jackie Kennedy, due to the Vietnam War, wanted to kind of stay away from the Johnson White House, and as I said, was for Robert Kennedy running for president in 1968. In fact, Bobby had famously said, I'm not going to decide whether I'd run or not unless I get the okay from Jackie. That's an actual quote. I mean, she became his political Buddha. He would go to her and make sure that what he was doing made sense and that it wasn't going to damage what it would be like for family life. And she, at that point, they both had a kind of fatalistic view of life. Jackie Kennedy worried that Bobby was in great danger, that there was that violence and hate was permeating the land in 68. She warned him about that, but she also said, you've got to go for it. And that way she was stayed very loyal to the Kennedy family in political terms.
Let me just add one point that Doug touched on briefly. Many people thought that Jackie Kennedy cared about fashion, cared about the arts, cared about renovation, cared about her children, which she obviously did, all of those things. And people thought she wasn't that involved in what was going on politically or wasn't as knowledgeable about public affairs as maybe some first ladies have become. The truth is, it turns out that when Caroline Kennedy released a little earlier than was supposed to be released, I think the tapes that Jackie Kennedy had done with Arthur Schlesinger shortly after the assassination, it turned out she knew an enormous amount of things that had been going on politically, and she had observations about cabinet members and White House staff, and she was quite knowledgeable, though she had shielded that knowledge from the public when she was first lady.
Yeah, and you know, when she was, before she got married, she worked with the Washington Times Herald, as it was called, and they hired her to be called what was called inquiring camera girl. And what she would do is go on the streets and take photographs of, have a photograph taken of people, and then would write about what they thought for the newspaper needed to go on into government. And in fact, she even did an interview of Tricia Nixon, the child of Dick and Pat Nixon, for that newspaper. So she was involved with, you know, journalism with Vogue and the Washington and Times Herald before she met John F. Kennedy, and that interest in the news, what was happening. And I mean, news by the minute. John F. Kennedy would read every newspaper he could get his hands on, and so did she.
Here's a question. Did Mrs. Kennedy ever return to the White House for a visit after the Kennedy presidency?
Yes, I just mentioned when Lyndon Johnson, requesting the moonshot, but she would come and get returned. But it was Nancy Reagan who really extended this. You know, there was no love with Jimmy Carter. The Kennedys, of course, Ted Kennedy ran against Carter in 1980. But when Reagan came in, Nancy Reagan did cartwheels, bent over backwards to make Jacqueline Kennedy feel at home back in the White House. She was treated almost like royalty by Ronald and Nancy Reagan. And so she appreciated that. And I knew Nancy Reagan once told me how angry she was that George W. Bush, when he was president, didn't call her on her birthday. And yet Ted Kennedy called her that day and sang Happy Birthday and Danny Boy to her on the phone. So the Kennedy family and the Reagans had a lot of, they had an interesting personal dynamic between them.
They invited Mrs. Kennedy back to the White House to see the beautiful Aaron Schichter portrait of President Kennedy. And they saw that there in the cross hall and then were actually in the White House on the state floor. And then that evening with the president, it was understood to be a very powerful and poignant time for her to return to the White House on that occasion. Here's a question about state dinners and entertaining in the Kennedy White House, how that differed from presidencies prior to them or even following.
Well, I would say that her dinners were tickets that were very much, or invitations very much sought after, because she would bring in the most celebrated artists and personalities in the country. It wasn't just government people or political people, but it was the arts and other people who were really cerebral. And as a result, many people wanted to attend those dinners, and they were quite famous. And I think it was the beginning of people saying, well, I really want to go to a White House state dinner. And many prominent people since that time have actually wanted to go to state dinners because they've elevated a bit more than they had been in the prior administrations.
Here's a question that in studying Mrs. Kennedy, was there an oh wow moment that you learned something that most people would not know about her?
Well, because I was writing a book about American Moonshot, I was amazed that she started corresponding with Werner von Braun, the German rocketeer who worked in Huntsville, Alabama, who was designing the Saturn rockets to go to the moon, and that she would tell von Braun to keep Jack in mind. Von Braun put the initials JFK on an early rocket to make sure that the idea that she kept focusing on that going to the moon being a Kennedy accomplishment. And of course it was. And as I write about when that big moment occurred, when Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin and Michael Collins returned safely on the Apollo 11 mission at Mission Control, they put up Kennedy's moon challenge. We'll put a man to the moon and bring him back by the end of the decade. And that was a big moment for old Joe Kennedy, who was alive still, and to see that his son's mission was fulfilled. And Jackie Kennedy felt some closure because she felt that one big part of the legacy she thought would matter for John F. Kennedy had been fulfilled. And indeed, it does. When I talk to young people now about Kennedy, it used to be everybody was interested in just the Cuban Missile Crisis, Peace Corps, and Berlin Wall. I find now people are really interested in the moonshot and going to the moon, and then Kennedy's role in the civil rights movement and the great speech he gave at the time Medgar Evers was killed, and the fact that after Martin Luther King's famous "I Have a Dream" speech, that the leaders at the Lincoln Memorial were invited back to the White House after that historic day. That civil rights and space seemed to be catching on with young people at Kennedy's legacy a little more than some of the Cold War theatrics these days.
Let me just add something that people may know, but Jackie Kennedy, from the time she became First Lady and certainly after she was First Lady, was the most famous woman in the world. It's not even clear who number two or three or four was. She was by far the most famous woman. But she was most concerned not with her fame and not with other kinds of public adulation. She was most concerned about raising her children. And she famously said something that I often quote, which is, if you mess up raising your children, nothing else in life really matters. And so to her, raising her children to be well-adjusted young individuals and adults was really her real legacy, and that's what she took great pride in. And she was fortunate to be able to live long enough to see some grandchildren from Caroline.
And that's a perfect note to wrap up our conversation and our questions from the audience. I want to thank both of you, not just for being with us today, but for your friendship and support of our organization, for all you do for our country and for history, and the importance of maintaining an understanding and the knowledge of American history by all Americans. It's critically important.
Thank you very much.
Take care.
Thanks, Doug. Good to see you. Thanks, Stuart.
David, bye. Bye,
Stuart. For everyone still with us, we have a very special treat for you to close our program today. Former executive pastry chef at the White House, Roland Mesnier, served five presidents and first ladies over 25 years. In this special vignette introduced by his chef colleague, Mark Ramsdale, Chef Mesnier will take us on a little bit of a journey into the Kennedy presidency and some special treats that the Kennedys enjoyed for their state dinners.
Hello, my name is Mark Ramsdale. I'm a friend and colleague of Chef Roland Mesnier, who is here today to help celebrate the birthday of Mrs. Jacqueline Kennedy. Mrs. Kennedy and Roland would have gotten along very nicely because Roland was very classically trained, as was the chef that she hired to be her executive chef, René Verdon. There are other reasons that Roland would get along very well with Mrs. Kennedy. Mrs. Kennedy spoke French fluently. She was trained in classic service, and that's what Roland appreciated the most. In this short piece, Roland will now actually reflect on some of the menus used by Mrs. Kennedy. Chef, when you look at the menu cards from the Kennedy era, many times in the dessert, we see a frozen product like sorbet. You use sorbet a lot.
A lot, yes. From every flavor you can possibly imagine.
One of the things we also know is that you are quite famous for your constructions of the desserts and that you used a lot of molds. Chef, I assume that those molds go back into the Kennedy era, no?
Oh, probably even beyond that. You know, I'm sure she may have seen some because they used that a lot in the old hotel in New York. They all had those collection of molds. This is where I was able to purchase some of those molds myself.
What other cold desserts would you serve at the White House in addition to a sorbet dessert?
Well, we did a lot of frozen souffle, which Mrs. Kennedy loved any type of souffle. And a lot of the time, my souffle would have like a hole in the middle where we would pile up some fresh fruit in sauce or whatever she would choose. And that was a very special dessert to have at the White House.
We were paging through several of the Kennedy dinner dessert cards, and the term bon glacé comes up many times.
Yes, yes.
And what is a bon?
A bon is anything molded, kind of in a dome fashion, and will have several layers, several flavor in the same presentation. And then around that, again, fresh fruit and special sauces. Remember, we always had sauces with the dessert.
We know from books that have been written that Mrs. Kennedy liked a lot of classic desserts, light desserts. And I see a card here where one of those relatively light desserts comes to mind, the strawberry vacherin. So
yes.
What is a vacherin?
A vacherin is a meringue shell. Can be, if it's for a dessert for 10 people, then you made a big meringue shell that would be filled with different sorbet or ice cream. And again, accompaniment with a special sauce and also fresh fruit. The recipe are in all the books that we did together with the association. They're still on sale today. And they're a wonderful gift. And I would encourage you to go into that to produce something very, very special.
Thank you, Chef Roland and Chef Mark. And as Chef says, our books are available, including chef's own books published with us, our website, whitehousehistory.org, where you can learn more about Mrs. Kennedy, all of the first ladies who have influenced the White House and its beautiful, incredible museum standard interiors. And remember, we are a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization. We depend on the support from private individuals like you. And we're very grateful during this challenging time to receive your support. You can make a donation to the association through our website, whitehousehistory.org. If you've not yet registered for our program at noon tomorrow, you can do so on our website, as well as the program Friday afternoon at 5:30. We look forward to seeing you for both of these programs when we honor Mrs. Kennedy as the founder of the White House Historical Association. Thank you very much. Have a terrific day.